Hi everybody, thank you for being here. I'm Alban. I work as a software engineer at Criteo in the scalability team, mostly working on service discovery, hence the load balancing and metrics. Let me tell you the story of a journey, the journey of Criteo from the monolith to services with client-side load balancing. I'll share with you our failures and success we got on the path. To begin with, let me give you a bit of context. To display an ad, you need basically four applications. One to track the users and get a profile. One to place a bid to set a price for an ad space for a given user. A banner renderer and a click counter. A long time ago, those four applications were basically a big monolith. And on one side, we had the internet, the users, and on the other side, we had the applications. They were between them, we had an F5 load balancer that was doing just round robin on a pool of servers. That was quite simple, quite efficient, but not so scalable. Because after a while, we were no longer to work with those mega monoliths. They became too complex. We had a lot of spaghetti code, and we were not able to release anything for around 6 months. That's when the idea of splitting them into services came to make them easier to understand, easier to maintain, to have a better ownership of the code. And with that, now we have a pool of servers that need to talk with another pool of servers. This is how we first introduced HAProxy, because F5 are very expensive. HAProxy runs on a regular server. It's open source. It's efficient. At this time, we had gigabit links. So it has 1 gigabit link input and 1 gigabit link output. It's a bit better now, but at this time, we had only that. And this is when a problem started to rise, because for our request rate, around 200K requests per second at this time, and the size of the payloads, we needed much more bandwidth than we actually had. So we started to optimize. On one end, on the hardware side, we did link aggregation. So we bound several network interfaces together to make them act as one. So it increased the bandwidth available on this virtual network interface. And on software side, we did compression on the payload. So we lost a bit of CPU, but won a bit of bandwidth. But we had to wonder, do we really need this HAProxy? Because even after those optimization, we needed around 45 HAProxies per data center, which we considered to be too much. And HAProxy was either a SPOF and a SPOC, so we considered completely removing it. And this is how client-side load balancing appeared, because as opposed to outside traffic, we controlled both ends of the pipe, either the client, it's our code, and the server, it's our code too. So nothing prevented us from providing the list of all the servers to all the clients. Let's talk about the algorithm. And to begin with, I'll give you some figures. When we introduced it, we had around 250 clients and around 300 servers. We considered that the Cartesian product of the client times servers was a bit too much. So we thought we couldn't open so many network connections. So we started with the first intuitive idea. And at this time, we were so happy to have so much traffic that we thought just the volume plus the randomness would balance automatically things. So a client chose n node randomly in the server pool, and it did round robin on them. As a result, we noticed that some server received much more traffic than others. The variance was huge. As you can see on the graph, you've got here the traffic rate per server. The average difference was around 100% between the least loaded and the most loaded server. So for scaling, it's a big issue because we had to scale for the worst case. So many servers were underloaded. So it was a huge waste of resources. So we moved to a more deterministic solution. We used windowed round robin by giving to the clients the knowledge of their position in the pool. And so the first client could take the first n contiguous node and do round robin on it. The next client take the n following, and so on. It's good overall. We reduced a lot the variance, but not enough. A perfect graph will be a single line because that would mean all servers receive the exact same amount of traffic, so they are perfectly balanced. And by the way, this works fine when all servers are up, but when one is down, the remaining traffic is rebalanced just on that small pool per client. So the traffic increases for the remaining nodes, and at some point, everybody dies. I told you we didn't consider doing full mesh, meaning making the clients talk to all the servers. But we didn't try when we decided that. So we actually tried, and the fun thing is that it worked. Actually, it worked only for a while, because when we reached 1,024 servers, our routers crashed. It's a funny number. And it's also, by default, the size of the ARP cache. It has 1,024 entries. The ARP cache does the mapping between an IP and a MAC address. So when this cache is full, it's flushed. And for every request, the client had to query broadcast, hey, who's got IP 1234? And it got the answer, it's John. And then for the next IP, who's got IP 1234? The cache was flushed, so we had to rebroadcast the thing. And this is how we crashed our routers. The fun thing is that we had the same issue with our Linux machines around 6 months ago, and we patched them, but not the Windows servers. So we did it. Now it works. After a while, we bought some more servers, a new generation of them. So the new one could handle much more traffic than the old ones. So what should we do with them? Should we give them the same amount of traffic as the small one and waste resources? Probably not. This is how we introduce the weighted round robin, which has the same advantages of the regular round robin. It's still very deterministic, but we had to determine weight for those new servers. It's empirical. We had just to measure what traffic they could handle. Those weights may change over time, and we are not sure after each release that those weights are correct. To give you the result, this is a graph from yesterday. You can see that the traffic rate is almost aligned for each generation of server. By measurement, we determined that the new server needed a weight of 30 and the old needed a weight of 20. And if you look at the average figures, the old server receive around two-thirds of the new generation traffic. Let's move to another topic, which is health checks, because clients need to talk only to healthy servers. A long time ago, not so far away, we had an in-house service discovery system which had the knowledge of all our nodes for a given service, but had no idea about their health. So every client had to perform a health check on every server it targeted. So as we are doing full mesh, it made a lot of network traffic plus a huge CPU usage. So it impacted performance. Since we migrated to Consul, Consul is able to perform its own health checks on servers. So now we've got only one service performing health check on all the servers. And the clients are able to query Consul to get only the healthy nodes, and so everybody wins bandwidth and CPU. This is where the story stops for today, but it's a never-ending story because it's constantly evolving. For instance, we're currently working on adapting the weights of the server according to the latency. Somebody working on that topic is hidden here. I'll let you find him and talk with him. Thank you for your attention, and feel free to ask any questions.
Be careful.
Thank you for the presentation. One thing that I didn't get at the beginning is why was the round robin, the first round robin implementation, not balanced correctly? The very first one, it was apparently the worst.
The
case.
Random subset?
Yeah.
Actually, we've got a pool of servers, let's say 100 servers. A client takes randomly 10 of them and it does round robin on it. So it picks randomly some servers, and we think that randomness makes the balance, but actually it did not.
Okay. Do we know what's the cause of that? Is it because the randomness is not so random, or have you investigated that? It was just a question.
I didn't work on that, so I have not all the context, but probably that the volume are too small to have a real effect of randomness. When we've got 300 servers and we take only 10 of them, it's not so random.
In one of the latest implementation, you were speaking about health checks done at the client level on every single servers. Did you try to just not do health check, but remember that the last call was failing? Not be proactive, but more reactive on the health checks?
Honestly, I don't know.
Okay.
Any more questions? Thank you.